a recap Monday. I hope you guys are having a fantastic, magical, wonderful, fantastic start to your week. I am, for the most part. It's my day off, so of course I'm having a good day. And after the weekend I had, I need a day off. Like, we did more at work in 3 days than we normally do in an entire week. So it was crazy, it was fast paced, it was nuts, I'm exhausted. I was at work till like 10 o'clock last night because we had to reset the store on top of everything else. And today I've just been insane. Like, I was busy this morning, and then the kids came home from school and I had to get dinner done, and now I'm just getting the video done. So it's gonna be uploaded late, but it will be there nonetheless. It's just life. My house is a wreck. Like, and by a wreck, I mean, like, I don't do cups on the table. I don't do towels over the chair. It's driving me nuts, and the fact that I know it's back there now is going to make my blood pressure rise, but it will be okay. At least they're Avengers cups. You know, par for the course around here. We're just one big household of nerds. It's okay. So, you know, it is what it is. But we're not here to talk about Avengers cups in the background or the fact that I've had the weekend from you know what. We are here for GA Recap Monday, where I recap the newest episode of Ghost Adventures, Ghost Adventures Aftershocks, or as the case has been the past few weeks, Zach's new show, Deadly Possessions. And this week was the most twisted episode yet. It was cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs cray cray. They discussed Ed Gein's cauldron and the crying boy paintings. And both of these stories are insane. Both of them have histories behind them that are just odd and weird. And so, as always, I like to save the best for last. So we're going to save that creepy freaking cauldron for last and talk about the creepy freaking paintings instead. The crying boy painting is about a little boy. His family died in a fire. And it said that the boy's cursed. He basically starts fires wherever he goes. And an artist painted this little boy, and he's crying in the picture. And it says now that the paintings are cursed, and any replicas of the paintings are cursed, and that wherever you put them, if you put them in your house or if you put them in your business or whatever, it'll catch on fire. And the woman who owned the crying boy paintings went in search of these things. This wackadoodle went in search of these paintings and found them and put them in her house, and sure enough, they caught on fire. She was kind of dissing the paintings in her head, saying that they weren't very cute, they weren't very pretty, whatever, and sure as shit, her house caught on fire. And then shortly after that, that was when she found the first one, and then she found the second one, and sure enough, shortly after that, she was doing the same thing, and her computer blew up and kind of caught on fire. Come on, for real? No. Zach was very apprehensive about these. I mean, he was very, like, ugh. Because he had heard the stories of the crying boy paintings and how in the 80s, you know, a house had them in there and it decimated the entire house. There was nothing left except this painting. And this painting had no burns on it at all. No scuff marks, no nothing. It was perfectly in pristine shape and the whole house was ash. And this painting was perfect. So Zach was very apprehensive about taking these paintings. But the woman was like, I'm not taking them home with me. I'm not doing it. I'm not bringing them back. I'm not taking them home. And so Zach kept them, but he was very apprehensive about it, and he even apologized to the painting and was like, I hope that helps. And he was very adamant to Billy. He's like, I swear to God, you watch every room in this house. If you see so much as a flicker out of place, you let me know. You flip on that oh shit light that they've got, the red one, and just let me know what's up, because if this burns down, like, none of this stuff can be replaced. Like, everything he's got. And can you imagine if that of all places burnt to the ground, like, for real? Like, that is the, like, probably one of the most haunted locations ever, because it houses some of the most haunted, cursed objects in the world. Can you imagine if you pissed off all of those spirits even more than they already are now? Oh, hell no. I can't even imagine what would happen. They would be like one big gaggle of negativity. Like, I can't even imagine that would literally be the pits of hell. It would literally be the pits of hell. I don't even want to think about it. It makes my head spin in circles just trying to think about it. So I can understand Zach's apprehension. And as for me, I would not have something like that in my house. I mean, it's really bad. You know, it's bad, like, when an art gallery guy comes in and talk about the paintings and kind of give you history about the paintings and is like, oh, hell no. I'm not even taking the chance of putting that thing in my place overnight. Like, Zach wanted him to as an experiment. Nope, bye, Felicia. Because it doesn't have to happen that night. It can happen like 2 weeks later. Yeah, no. I don't blame them at all. Never would happen in my lifetime. No, thank you. Bye-bye. Huh. Now, moving on to the second half of the recap, which is actually the first half of Deadly Possessions, Ed Gein's cauldron. Now, he inspired Psycho, He was one of the most notorious serial killers ever. He was a twisted, jacked up individual. Just saying. He would murder these people, or he would go and bury, unbury bodies, and you know, take the skin off of them and debone them and use the bones for furniture. And like, you can't even begin to wrap your head around the things that this man would do. You know, he would take skin, and he would take female human skin and tie it all together so that he could wear it and become his mother. What the F? He would make furniture out of human bones. You know, when the cops went into the house and found all this stuff, they found belts made out of human skin. They found skulls. They found, you know, like just massive amounts of stuff that represented human like bodies. Like, he had decimated all of these people for his own personal gain. And the guy, you know, that owned the cauldron, Dan, he was like, you know, one of the most profound things was he had a nipple, like a doorbell. What? Now, I have seen and heard some jacked up things in my day. That one was new to me. I was speechless. Like, I have no words. Like, I can't imagine what goes through somebody's head. What sick thing goes through your head to even remotely think that what you're doing is okay? Like, that is a whole new level of crazy that I can't even begin to wrap my head around. It sickens me. It's just disgusting to me. And so he would take this cauldron and he would put, you know, like entrails in it, and he'd cook things in it, like people and crap and weirdness and ew. And so it was acquired by Dan's family through an auction at Ed Gein's home. His grandmother had bought it. She used to put flowers in it. Normal thing to do. Cool. Not necessarily this particular cauldron. So they did that, and they put flowers in it, and they did all this stuff. And then when it got put in the garage at Dan's, you know, family's home, they were all cleaning out the garage. And within a matter of like 18 months, everybody who helped clean out the garage, Dan's mother, his brother-in-law, his uncle, I believe, and someone else, all passed away within like a very short amount of time. And so it was just like, it was one of those coincidental things that you just don't think about. And so the question was, is there a negative energy around the cauldron? And I believe absolutely. Hearing the stories that they told and hearing the things that would happen or whatever, it's no doubt in my mind that there is some sort of negativity. How can there not be? I mean, this is a cauldron of death. Literally, it is a cauldron of death. And I think that it is something that does have a lot of negative energy around it because of what it was used for. It was used to cook decimated bodies. That is a breeding ground of negativity and nastiness. And so, hands down, without a doubt, there is no doubt in my mind that it breeds nastiness and negativity, and it just makes me chill. Like, I'm just creeped out by it. Like, it's just crazy. I mean, it's not only the cauldron. They, you know, Zach had another interview set up to meet with this couple who had a pair of skis that were Ed's, and they had to cancel the interview with them and send her daughter and her boyfriend because the sister, the girl's sister, had a stroke out of nowhere. And they fully believed that it was the skis that they had. And so they were shipping him to Zach. They didn't want him anymore. And so they, you know, got to talk about that and how they believed that those had a negative attachment as well. So I think it's anything that this man owned or had in his possession is just breeding negativity. And so, of course, this one, you know, led Zach to want to do an investigation around the cauldron, and he did. And he got massive EMF spikes around the cauldron. He got EVPs and results out of the spirit box saying death. And I think that's the best way to put it. I think anything surrounding this is just a breeding ground of negativity and grossness and death. And it was just creepy and crazy and twisted. Oh my. Just gives me the chills thinking about it. But that is all I have for GA Recap Monday. I will be back on Friday for GA Flashback Friday, where I recap a past episode of Ghost Adventures. Until then, stay happy, stay healthy, have a magical, wonderful, amazing rest of your week. Much love and happiness, guys. Bye.